justice, O God, plead my cause against a nation that is faithless. From the deceitful and cunning, rescue me. For you, O God, are my strength. Special intention for this Mass is for Louise Dickman. In the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, all. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. For Jesus, you raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For Jesus, you bring pardon and peace to the sinner. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. For Jesus, you bring light to those in darkness. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God. Let us pray. Let us pray. By your help we beseech you, Lord our God, that we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Your Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, O my people, I will open your graves and have you rise from them, and bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and have you risen from them, O my people. I will put my spirit in you that you may live, and I will settle you upon your land. Thus you shall know that I am the Lord. I have promised and I will do it, says the Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. The Lord, there is mercy and fullness of redemption. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice, to my voice in supplication. The Lord, there is mercy and fullness of redemption. If you, O Lord, mark iniquities, Lord, who can stand? With you is forgiveness that you may be revealed. With the Lord, there is mercy and fullness of redemption. I trust in the Lord. My soul trusts in his word. More than sentinels wait for the dawn, but Israel wait for the Lord. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the earth is kindness, with the Lord is kindness, and with him is plenteous redemption. He will redeem Israel from all their iniquities. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. A reading from the letter of St. Paul. Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, with his Spirit dwelling in you. Word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Lord be with you. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Lord to you. No man was ill. Lazarus from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who had anointed the Lord with perfumed oil and dried his feet with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was ill. So the sisters sent word to Jesus saying, Master, the one you love is ill. When Jesus heard this, he said, This illness is not to end in death, but is for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was ill, he remained for 2 days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just trying to stone you. You want to go back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in a day? If one walks during the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks at night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him." He said this and then told them, "Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but I'm going to awaken him." So the disciples said to him, "Master, if he is asleep, he will be saved." Jesus was talking about his death, so they thought that he meant ordinary sleep. So then Jesus said to them clearly, "Lazarus has died, and I am glad for you that I was not there, that you may believe. Let us go to him." So Thomas, called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go to die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world." When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary secretly, saying, "The teacher is here and is asking for you." As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. For Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So when the Jews who were with her in the house comforting her told Mary, "Get up quickly and go out," they followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled and said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Sir, come and see." And Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died?" So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him, "Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. Because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them, "Untie him and let him go." Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done began to believe in him. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning, everyone. You're all doing well. I miss having you all here. This is the second Sunday in which we have not been able to gather as a community. And I'm getting used to saying Mass by myself. The preaching with no one in front of me is taking a little longer to get used to, but I'm starting to become a little more accustomed to that as well. But I do miss you, and I pray for you every day. I ask God to bless you and to help you to stay connected to the church and connected to one another. I hope that you are calling one another, checking in with friends and family, and making sure that everybody is okay, remembering that we are church, that we are community, that we're in this together, and that together with our with support of each other and the support of our prayer for one another, we're going to get through this. Especially, we pray for those who are ill, those if any of you are among those who have caught the coronavirus, we pray for you and for your families and loved ones at this time. So I want to talk about the scriptures. You know, 2 weeks ago, we had the story of the woman from Samaria at the well. And we see it begins with a discussion of physical thirst. And then Jesus leads the woman in her understanding to a discussion of spiritual thirst. The thirst of the human heart that can only be satisfied by God himself filling us. As these are the living waters of the Spirit that Jesus talks about there. That he is the one that can give us this living water that will spring up from within us. We will never thirst again because it will give us our sense of purpose and meaning and direction. It will give us a sense of fullness and wholeness that we long for. So we see it begins with material thirst, leads to spiritual thirst. Last week we had the story of the man born blind. And two, we begin with the idea of a physical blindness. But as Jesus goes on and as the story goes on, it becomes more and more about spiritual blindness, those who are spiritually blind. And who are those who are spiritually blind? They're really all of us. All of us until we have been enlightened by Christ, because he is the light of the world. Today we have the story of Lazarus, who is dead. He is a dead man. Physically, materially, he is dead. But as the other stories were about not only the material reality, but the spiritual reality, this story, too, is about those who are spiritually dead, and that Christ wants to raise those who are spiritually dead to new life. And who are those who are spiritually dead? Well, the entire human race starts off this way. Ever since the fall of our first parents, we are born separated from God. We are born with the missing the indwelling of the Holy Trinity, that sanctifying grace that makes us alive. And Jesus is the one that comes to give us that sanctifying grace so that we might come back to life. We might become a new creation in him. And that's what the story is talking about, right? It's talking about this spiritual renewal for the Christian, The risen life does not begin at the moment of death, and it does not begin at the resurrection of the just at the end of time. The risen life for Christians begins at baptism. St. Paul, in his theology, as he is baptizing people, and Paul wouldn't have had a church to come to, and he would not have a baptismal font to baptize someone in. He would go down to the river or down to a lake, and that's where he would baptize someone. And he would dunk them under three times. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And what is the mythology of being out in the water and going under for the third time? It is at the third time we drown. We drown. And that's what baptism tells us. This is what St. Paul tells us. He says that the going into the water of baptism is a going into the tomb with Christ. And then coming up out of the water of baptism is a rising with Christ. And so we Christians who have been baptized, we have already died. We have already died and have begun the new life in Christ. So we see Jesus standing outside the tomb of Lazarus and saying, Lazarus, come out. That's you and me at our baptism. He calls to us, come out, come out. And through the waters of baptism, he fills us with his Holy Spirit, with the Holy Trinity. He takes away all of our sins and reunites us with God, reconciles us with God. Become truly spiritually alive. So this is what happens at baptism. That's why Easter is about baptism. At Easter, we are going to renew our baptismal promises. We are going to recommit ourselves to following Christ as his disciples. We rededicate ourselves to this risen life, this new life that we are called to. There's another point in the story that I want us to notice. When Jesus calls Lazarus out of the tomb, Lazarus comes out of the tomb. He is wrapped in the burial cloths, and there is a cloth covering his head. Now, one point there is to realize what John is doing here, this is John's gospel, is he is pointing to realities of Jesus' own resurrection. There is a tomb, and the stone has been rolled away. There are the burial cloths that are left behind, that had wrapped Jesus, covering even his face, that are left behind there. But as he calls Lazarus out, Lazarus is still bound. He is still bound by these burial cloths. What does this tell us? It tells us that even after we have been baptized, that we still struggle. We are still bound in many ways. Every one of us, we are bound by what? By our guilt, by our shame, by our fear, by our anger and resentment, by our greed, by our lust, for our longing for more and more of this world's goods. These bind us. They bind us and keep us from being the men and women that God is calling us to be. And so as Jesus says to them standing there, unwrap him, unbind him. So too, he sends his grace to unbind us, to set us free. Now, to being called out of the tomb, that's salvation. That's salvation. Salvation is only the first movement. The second movement is called sanctification. And that's what the unwrapping of the burial bands is all about. We must be sanctified. Even though we have been baptized, many of us recognize that we're not as holy as we would like to be, or as holy as we think we ought to be. And so what is it that keeps us from that? Sin. It's a sin that lives within us. It's a sin that binds us. And St. Paul says that those who sin are slaves to sin. So this is the binding. And so not only does Christ want to sanctify us, to save us, he wants to sanctify us and make us holy as well. And so on this fifth Sunday of Lent, let us praise God for this salvation which he has brought about in you and me. And if there are any of you who are listening who are not yet baptized, we pray for you that that day will come soon, that you will choose to be baptized, that you will respond to the voice of Jesus who is saying, come out of the tomb, come out of the tomb. And for all of us, that we will seek to cooperate with the grace of God so that we might become unbound, unbound by those sins and those other realities of this world which keep us from being saints, that keep us from being holy, that keep us from being fully the sons and the daughters of God. We now profess our creed. I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. In him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. He rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. And his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen. We now turn to our Heavenly Father with our petitions. Pray for our Holy Father, Francis. For all of our bishops around the world, especially Bishop Boyce, who is the bishop of the Diocese of Covington. We pray for all priests and all ministers who, in this very unusual time, are this time of being separated from the church, that they will not drift away from the faith. But in fact, they will use this time to pray more deeply, to learn more about their faith, and actually draw closer and pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are dying, that they will be sustained by true faith and trust, that they will be raised from the dead, and that they will be restored to new life in the kingdom of God. We pray to the Lord. We pray for those who are spiritually dead, those who have not yet been baptized, not come to Christ. We pray for those who perhaps have come to Christ but have fallen into lives of sin and are overwhelmed by the darkness of this world. They might come to know that light that comes from Him, that healing and life that comes from Him. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all of us, that each one of us will learn to cooperate with the grace of God more completely, so that we might be set free from all sin, stain of sin, so that we might truly be sons and daughters of God, reflecting His light, His truth, and His beauty. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for healthcare workers. We pray for all of those who are seeking to minister in any way to those who are sick, especially those who are suffering from this coronavirus. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Blessed art thou among women, blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God, of all creation. For your goodness we receive the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. Come for us. Blessed be God forever. To share the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for the goodness we receive in one. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, our spiritual truth. Blessed be God. The humble spirit and contrite heart may be accepted by you, O Lord. May our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Wash me, O Lord, from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Lord, accept the sacrifice at our hands. Praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Amen. Hear us, Almighty God, and having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrifice. Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts and lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, Christ, O Lord. For as true man, he wept for Lazarus, his friend, as Eternal God raised him from the tomb. Just as, taking pity on the human race, he leads us by sacred mysteries to new life. In him, the host of angels adores your majesty, rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, for the power and working of the Holy Spirit, give life to all things and make them whole. But you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, your sacrifice may be offered to your name. For, O Lord, we humbly implore you, for the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration. They may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, whose command we celebrate is in years. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. Broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat. This is my body, which will be given up." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. This in memory." The mystery of faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. For, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. For we pray upon the oblation of your church, recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with St. Joseph, your spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence you rely for unfailing love. In the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Please to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, and Roger, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion and merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Our departed brothers and sisters, all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your reward, Christ, O Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, and we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, ever and ever. Amen. Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I give you, my peace I give you," look not in our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to suffer. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my soul shall be. Everyone who lives and believes in me will not die forever, says the Lord. Let's pray. Pray, Almighty God, we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. And ever. Bless you. Bless, O Lord, your people who long for the gift of your mercy. Grant that what in your prompting they desire, they may receive by your generous gift. Christ, Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son.